January 24th. We are doing our meeting through Zoom. So we have the quorum. Let's start the meeting. President report. I don't have any report except that Happy New Year to you all. And hope things are the best. Addition and change to the agenda. In our new business, we will talk about the candidate filing, redistricting and precinct and all of that subject, which is not in the agenda.
Naheed, I would like to also add committees.
Yes, yeah.
As new business.
Yes, okay. We will talk about the committee too.
And Naheed, we're going to have an executive session, actually, too. One to discuss drop boxes and then a personnel matter.
Yes, that's. Anything else? We can talk under old or new business. We can always add it. We don't have to say that. Campaign contribution. Who's the rich one? Contributed to the candidate. And I'm no. At least no, I know it's no. Okay. Anybody else?
Not for me.
It's no. All right. Thank you. Public comment. Lisa, do we have anybody signing to talk to us?
Ms. Cozumel, no one requested to address the board in advance.
Thank you very much. Election director report. Allison, acting election director.
A written director's report was distributed to the board and is also on the board's website. I'll summarize it with the exception of the items in the report that I know we'll be taking up in other parts of the agenda. The agenda for the meeting was posted and provided to the board members along with draft minutes in the budget spreadsheet on January 14th. The action items from the previous meeting are that notice of action was posted on the website for the designation of the alternate early voting sites and the designation of the drop box locations. The order was placed for the additional drop boxes with the State Board of Elections, consistent with the board's December vote. And I also wanted to report back to you at your request as an action item that board staff did contact the voter. The board had reviewed a ballot from a voter where the oath had been signed in 2020, but the ballot had not been postmarked until 2021. The question of the board was this just the tip of the iceberg of some sort of a systemic issue? We did contact the voter. We contacted election officials in Massachusetts where this had been a ballot from a college student. Neither the election officials in Massachusetts nor the officials with the Postal Service that we spoke to indicated any knowledge of any systemic issue with ballots from that particular college campus. But we did check into that, and we have not identified any suggestion that that isolated ballot was an indication of any sort of a larger problem.
May I ask a question about that?
Yes, please.
Does this suggest that the voter deposited a ballot for Montgomery County, Maryland, in a drop box in Massachusetts, and is that potentially a problem that we may want to make our communications clear that if you are out of state or out of county, that maybe you should not use your local drop box?
The voter, when we contacted them, indicated that they had deposited their ballot into a drop box in their college campus. And so that's what then prompted us to call. Actually, we called the college as well, and the college denied that they had sponsored any official drop boxes. And then we also contacted the election officials in Massachusetts and with the Postal Service, who did not know of any other situations that would indicate that this was a problem with other voters.
But we don't know at this point whether the ballot sat with Massachusetts election officials and then was mailed to us a year later, or whether it was with the post office. Other than the postmark is all the information that we have.
The impression that I have is that this voter had deposited this in some sort of a box arranged by some sort of a third party organization. Allison, an official Dropbox.
Did you personally speak with the voter?
I did not. Boris did.
Did he get the impression that this was just a misunderstanding? It sounds like pretty conflicting info.
I'm not sure. Boris, are you on the in the meeting that you have anything else to elaborate?
Yes, I'm here. I spoke to the voter. Voter informed me that there was a ballot box for placed on the campus for students from different states to place in their vote by mail ballots. Mm-hmm. And that's what she did.
Mm. And the campus says, no, there was no legitimate drop box on our campus.
According to the college VP, the office that I spoke to, it was not sanctioned by the college itself. It was a form of a student initiative that was organized on the campus. That's what I learned from the voter herself.
So it also was not sponsored by the election officials in Massachusetts?
Correct.
I could not confirm that. I just spoke to the voter. I went through, I think, 136 associations that exist on the college itself. I couldn't track the name of that particular association that student gave me. She just couldn't recall exact name that was placed on the box.
David, I think there might be an issue with, foreign states. I don't think have any legal authority to collect or handle Maryland absentee ballots. And your point about communication may well be a good one, but I think that. If you can only submit your ballot to a Dropbox and have it collected if it's in the state where you're voting.
Oh, absolutely. I'm not suggesting that we should enter into agreements with 50 other states to trade ballots. I'm just trying to understand what happened. I would say that this discussion did remind me that I don't remember whether we've added legislation to our agenda for today, but there is legislation.
Yeah, we can talk about it in the new business.
Yeah, because there is legislation in Annapolis to prohibit essentially non-election officials from collecting ballots in drop boxes. And I think that may be something that's worthy of our attention, because if there are organizations that are essentially putting up devices that are masquerading as official drop boxes, but then they're not responsible for them like we are, they don't collect them like we do, et cetera, that is a potential problem.
David, they didn't say that. I mean, Boris said he doesn't know the detail. The person didn't say somebody took the ballot and mailed it.
I think if you read between the lines, Naheed, what has been said thus far is that the student thought that this was a Dropbox and that named an organization that they thought was sponsoring it. No one can find that organization, and the university is saying they're not aware of a Dropbox being there. So I think that it's not too much of a jump to suggest that, I don't know enough about this situation. I don't even know which school it is, and it's in another state, but I think that it is possible that somebody dropped something into a Dropbox thinking that it was going to get to election officials and that it didn't. And it is certainly not impossible to believe that the same thing could happen somewhere else. You may recall, Naheed, that we had a situation a few elections ago where a faculty member of one of our high schools, with the best of intentions, collected a whole bunch of voter registration cards and didn't turn them in on time. And all those voters came to the polls and they were rejected because they weren't registered to vote, even though they thought they had signed their cards on time. So I think it's, I do think that this story, without our having every bit of knowledge about what happened, is indicative of a real potential problem.
Yeah, but we don't have control over people's lives, though, David. So how do we know that, this teacher is collecting that? We go there and say, no, don't do that, or bring the ballot. We don't have control.
Madam President, I do have...
I'm not saying it is right, but it's a major problem.
Madam President, I do have that bill listed under legislation, which I can cover that in the director's report, or if you'd like to put legislation in new business, we can take it up there.
Yeah, we can go on the new business. Yes. Okay.
The next item in the director's report is that the State Board of Elections met on December 16th, and they approved a number of final regulations defining the term ballot drop box, updating definitions for timeliness for submitting ballots in a drop box. They approved 13 of the board's requested 14 early voting sites. They deferred consideration of the 14th site pending formal documentation of county approval. The county council approved a resolution on January 18th, and my understanding is that they are forwarding that to the county executive's office for some level of formal recognition that this is formal approval by both the council and the executive. They are forwarding that documentation to the State Board of Elections, and the State Board will be taking that up at their meeting on January 27th.
Allison?
Mm-hmm.
Does that approval, that resolution by the council, mean that they're going to actually give us the money to stand this up?
The I did not cover that in the budget part of, well, I lightly covered that in the budget part of my report. The we do expect a supplemental appropriation to go over from the Office of Management and Budget to the council within the coming weeks, and I do expect that those costs will be included in that supplemental, yes.
If you're interested in another person's perspective, having observed the council, the answer to your question is yes.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, the council obviously knows we don't have any money, so
yes,
to the extent course. They approved it, they're gonna be paying for it.
I just wanted to be clear about that. That's yeah. all.
I think it's pretty clear. They have now said it twice because they sent us the original letter that didn't quite say it, and then the State Board went back to them and said, please do it officially, and they have.
David, maybe we should ask Alex to write a check. Okay.
I would not have the funds to do that.
I was going to say, Alex is a government employee. I don't think that would be a fair ask of him.
And I'm not in the check fighting business, Mr. Name.
Yes, exactly. I should have added that. Mr. Vincent is much too honest to write a check that he cannot support.
Thank you, guys.
We've been working very closely with the Office of Management and Budget on that supplemental request. I just want to update the board that what I think you can expect to see happen is that what OMB is going to forward over to the council is going to be it's not going to be the same number that the board requested, because some of what the board requested is not, it's really expenses that will not be incurred until the very end of the fiscal year. And so some of those expenditures, we don't need a supplemental for, and that will be accomplished most likely through a transfer, as they typically do at the end of the fiscal year. So the supplemental will be for the dollars that we need to really get us to that point through the end of the fiscal year. I do see, Madam President, I think there's at least one board member with a hand up.
Alan?
Yeah, I have a question, Madam President. My recollection is usually the budget subcommittee meets at some point before we do supplementals. Will the budget committee be meeting about this?
I believe the budget subcommittee did meet before the board forwarded the supplemental request over to the executive's office. I'm more than happy to meet again with the budget subcommittee, have staff meet with the budget subcommittee. I think that would be appropriate to review kind of our status, yes.
Did we meet Alan? I don't think, I don't
It was
remember.
Back in October we met.
Yeah.
In either October or November, you voted on the supplemental request.
But anyhow, it's good to have Allison, we meet with you, the treasurer, the budget committee.
Great.
Right, Alan?
Yeah, we met October 29.
Okay, then. Anyhow, it doesn't matter. It's just good to meet again, Allison. Schedule some budget meeting. Okay.
Thank Great. You. The fiscal 23 budget... The board's customary meeting with the county executive on that is tentatively scheduled for January 31st. I do not know whether you have yet received the invitations to that meeting, or if you want to have a budget subcommittee prior to that date. Right.
I would want to have a sense of kind of what we are presenting to the county executive before we meet with him, which I realize is just a week from now. I have not received any invitation or heard about it other okay. than from other than from so you.
We will the budget committee we will try to meet as soon as possible, and then we will email everybody about what we think, and then I assume we will get invitation to go to the before the.
Well, if in fact you're asking us to attend a meeting with the county executive to support the board's budget request for fiscal year 23, I think we need more than simply to be told about your subcommittee meeting. I would think that we would want to have the full picture. One question that I have that perhaps can be answered today, it seems that we are finalizing a supplemental request at the same time that we are talking to the county executive about the fiscal year 23 budget. Does the fiscal year 23 budget assume the approval of the supplemental, and does the county executive expect to hear from us about both?
The fiscal year 23 budget does not assume the adoption of the supplemental. They're really just separate submissions. And I'm happy to follow up with any documentation that the board wants as a whole, or that you want to funnel through a subcommittee.
Have we seen the proposed fiscal year 23 budget? Is that something we've met on previously?
I thought you did in the October subcommittee meeting, and then I'm not sure whether it was the October or the November board meeting.
Okay. Well, it was a while ago. Obviously, it would be helpful to have our memory refreshed. Do you know if the county executive will expect us to support not only our fiscal year 23 budget, but our supplemental request for 22?
Since the board met and approved a supplemental request that it forwarded to the Office of Management and Budget, and the Office of Management and Budget is now engaging in the follow-up discussions with us at a staff level on what OMB will then forward to the council. I don't know. We have not done, I think we might have done a supplemental once in the 10 years that I've been here before, so I don't know what the precedent was as far as the level of engagement of board members in that process. I'm more than happy to engage board members in it as much as you'd like.
Okay, my thought is just that based on the past meetings that I've attended with the county executive, and others have attended some of those, usually the OMB people are there. Given that we're there and the supplemental is obviously a very important thing for all of us, for the smooth operation of the primary, that it might make sense for us while we're at it to advocate for that as well. To ignore it would seem odd to me.
I think that's perfectly reasonable. I can certainly follow up with the county executive's office on expectations for covering the supplemental in the FY23 meeting.
Yes, good idea. Alan, yes. Alan?
Well, let me take down my hand.
Oh, okay. Your hand is still there.
Yeah, take it down.
Any other question? So Alison, you follow what we talk, okay?
Yep.
Thank you.
Got it.
One more very brief question. Is the meeting with the county executive going to be virtual or in person?
Virtual.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
And we provided your contact information to the county executive's office, so I'll follow up on to try to confirm the date and timing.
Okay. Any other question? No hand. Go ahead, Allison.
Year end, we had 675,622 active registered voters in Montgomery County. We had 66,390 inactive voters. And I have several items to cover under personnel. First, I'd like to welcome two new permanent merit employees, Angel Pinedo and Aisha Mills-Farigo. Angel is in voter registration in our bilingual position in voter registration. And Aisha is the new election judge recruiting coordinator. Aisha's name may be familiar to you because Aisha was one of our recruiters previously.
Are they on right now?
I do not know.
Is you mentioned one of the she's the judge coordinator. Is Deborah Hammer?
Yes.
Still in?
Yep. Yep. So we're staffing up in that team.
Okay. Thanks.
Jerry Corshi has been temporarily promoted to the position of senior information technology specialist, assuming day-to-day responsibilities for the IT division as Janet is serving as the acting deputy director. And Lisa Marino has been temporarily promoted because she is assuming many of the duties of the management and budget specialist position while that position is vacant as well. So congratulations to both Jerry and Lisa, and thank you for all of the extra work that you are doing. I also want to let you know that we have a recreation department employee who was on temporary detail to us. Patrick Walsh, who was one of the recreation department employees who assisted us in the 2020 election, is the county stat analyst for the Department of Recreation, helped us out with some projects at the time. And he has been detailed over from the recreation department for a 6-month period, again, because we are so downstaffed at the moment, to assist us with a variety of sort of analytical functions that are things that our administrative staff would normally be performing. And so we've had Patrick now with us here for just since the beginning of the year as well. And so it's nice to have the extra set of hands. I'm not sure if Patrick is on the line either.
Thanks, Allison. It's nice to meet everyone.
Right.
Hi.
Yes, Anna.
Madam, I have a question regarding the management and budget specialist position. Is that being advertised?
The management budget specialist position was advertised, and then we engaged in some conversations with the Office of Management and Budget about there's a new preferred staffing model that OMB is working on, where they have a new shared services unit that they have set up within OMB that is assisting with a number of the functions that that many departments perform at the department level. And so after the ad was pulled down while OMB did an evaluation with the Office of Human Resources and with us of what the needs are for that position. This is something that they've done with other departments as well. And based on that understanding, we have engaged the shared services unit within the Office of Management and Budget to help pick up a number of financial processing, things like issuing purchase orders, assisting us with contract, just managing the county's expectations and requirements for financial processing and contract administration. And so we have just started doing that with the Office of Shared Services, and we're going to provide some documentation of that understanding with shared services to the Office of Human Resources. And then the Office of Human Resources is going to reevaluate whether it is a management and budget specialist position or another classification series. My expectation is that it will be a different classification series that is what will be advertised instead. We are working to move forward as quickly on that as we possibly can. But I am grateful that Shared Services has stepped up to assist us in the meantime.
Thank you. Any questions, Bob?
Well, yeah. Will they understand our particular needs and our budget history?
Dieter Klinger, who has been with the county for many years, was the chief operating officer for the Department of Technology Services and worked very closely with us for a long time, is heading up that unit at OMB. So he understands our needs. And so I'm actually very, very confident and very optimistic that his team is going to be in a position to to navigate these processes with us and make sure that everything is running smoothly and we get the purchase orders issued and, you know, the documentation all done properly for the primary election.
Yes, David, your hand is up.
Yes, Alan, are you done?
Go ahead, I'm done.
Does this change at all the speed with which we are able to get our purchase orders done? Or in other words, will the board be losing any control over the ability to get things in time for the election that the county government, we would be kind of depending on them to decide the priorities of our requests?
Well, we're in transition. And so having unfortunately lost Kira in that position, you have Lisa and I initially took on those responsibilities, really primarily Lisa. And so Lisa has been able to move forward, but of course in transition, you know, where shared services is helping us to prevent delays.
Okay, my only concern would just be that if there are situations where there are any delays that are external to the board and its staff, that we be told as soon as possible, because obviously we want to avoid that. We want the board stuff to get the priority that it deserves.
Certainly.
Thank you.
We are currently conducting interviews for two positions, an election operations specialist and a vote by mail specialist, which will still leave us with two vacancies in the office. We've certainly had a lot of turnover for an office services coordinator and a supply technician. And so we will keep the board posted on the hiring process for those positions as well. We have 18 temporary employees in the building at this time, primarily in information technology and election judge recruiting and training. We are having some challenges in hiring, obviously the labor market. You all read the news and we know that the labor market is tight and we're seeing that. But we just sent out a solicitation to all active election judges in our system on Friday. And so I am optimistic that that will encourage some civically minded individuals who serve as election judges to perhaps step forward and apply for our temporary positions as well. The next, I'm not gonna try to cover every item. If there's anything in the director's report that I skip that you wanna make sure that I cover, let me know. The next key item in my report that I wanna make sure you all are aware of is that on December 23rd, we received the approval for requested modifications to the facility. And the Department of General Services has assigned a manager who has overall responsibility for the project. Again, lifting some of the responsibility for some of the processes on this from our staff, and the Department of General Services is helping us out in addition to the Office of Management and Budget. We have been very concerned about delays and about the prospect of getting the shelving that we need ordered, but the shelving is in stock and is going to be installed first because we do have voting equipment that needs to go on that shelving. We are currently working through the schedule with the Department of General Services and with our landlord to make sure that we get everything installed as we need it. Of course, you know, our initial desire was to have this work completed by January 31st. We're getting underway now, so that's not going to happen. But we're working out the timetable now, and I am confident that we're going to be able to get this work staged so that it is minimally disruptive to our operations and gets what we need before we need it. Certainly before we're in a position of having live ballots in the building where we're printing and mailing ballots or programming and testing voting equipment. I'm not concerned on that front. I also want to let you know that we've been moving very quickly on discussions about ballot sorting equipment, which the board has talked about previously. The state had issued a request for information for ballot sorting equipment last April and has been moving through the state procurement process. This is one of those things that the state has the authority to purchase on our behalf and then to bill us for through their quarterly billing. They identified a vendor and we are working forward I want to really thank the Office of Management and Budget for their assistance, both with this and with many other items of the report, the facility enhancement. They've been extremely helpful in helping us expedite things, as has the County Executive's Office. And so I am not in a position to, we do not have a go ahead yet on the ballot sorting equipment, but I am optimistic that we are going to get there, that we will get there, as well as I think a couple of the other large counties are in about the same place as we are, and hopefully ready to proceed with scheduling, installation, and that equipment will, of course, be incredibly helpful for us to avoid the extremely manual processes that we've been using for handling absentee ballots. And in particular, going from having scaled up to 255 ballot styles for the last general election, this being the first primary election where we're implementing precinct-based reporting of election results, it will be the first time that we have 765 ballot styles. It's a Herculean task for our staff to physically sort ballots into 765 different categories and let voters know timely that their ballot was received. Those processes are incredibly difficult to do without automation. And so we're looking forward to having an automation solution in place to help us out in the primary. I will skip through redistricting because I know that that is on the agenda later. I understand that legislation you're going to add to new business as well. And so I believe the last item in my report then is each division within the department is reviewing the content on the department website to provide updates for the 2022 election. And Janet is scheduled to meet with the Department of Technology and Enterprise Business Solutions on January 28th to talk with them about making some modifications to the layout of our website. I'm not sure whether board members had specific questions about the website.
David, yes. Yes, David.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam President. First, before we get to the website, I want to congratulate you on whatever progress has been made on the ballot sorting equipment, which has the potential to be a major help in doing things faster, more efficiently, safer for public health because it requires fewer people and also less amenable to human error. So thank you for that. And if there's anything we can do to help, let us know. As far as the website goes, do you have a sense, or perhaps Janet has a sense, of the types of modifications we're talking about? And is the meeting that is scheduled for the 28th, is that a meeting, is that like the beginning of the process, or is that near the end of the process? Because I think that the board has expressed an interest in kind of being in the loop on website changes in the past.
Alyssa.
Janet, can you speak to that?
Yeah, I'll take that. It's the beginning of the process. I'm meeting with Chris Daniel, who actually, he normally revises updates our website every election. And so he wants to meet with me to talk about the issues. Like some of the pages, I don't like the layout. It's just too cumbersome. So we're going to talk about that. But my main focus is the main page. The things we need to have on the main page, like redistricting, and to have enough room to have the important stuff on the main page. So we're going to look at the redesign of that mainly, and a couple other pages.
Alex, I have a question.
Can I just follow up on that? Very, very briefly, okay. You mentioned redistricting, Janet. Do you know when it will be possible for people to see? I know that some of the districts have already been enacted, and some have not. And I don't know which of those are available on our website at this point.
None of it's available right now.
No. Yeah, it's not.
We can't do anything till the legislation finishes, and Alsoon is going to cover that in more detail. Because we don't have the final legislative changes. We got the congressional, we got the Board of Education, and we got the county.
Right.
We also got to get the other one. And Alsoon will tell you why.
Well, I understand that you can't make precinct changes until you have all the districts. But I guess the question is, as far as just informing the public about the congressional, the Board of Education, the county council districts, can we provide links to that information on our website?
Yes, that was one of the ones things I wanted to talk to Chris about. Can we just link, because I always go to their links to look at the data right now, because they have really good maps out there, interactive maps. So I wanted to see where we could provide links out to the other sites so that they can get the information. Because believe me, I'm getting questions every day in email.
Oh, I can imagine. I am as well, which is why I'm asking you. Right. So anyway.
Thank you,
thank you very much.
Okay. Alex.
Yes, thank you, Madam President. Allison, I had a question about the mock election. I know that was referenced in, I think, last meeting's report. Did we actually do one? And what were the results? What did you learn? Any issues or concerns?
Janet, can you speak to that as well?
Yes. The mock election that we had was more for SBE. They changed some of the back-end functions where they do the tabulation on their end and how they gather the data. So we were doing like a mini like vote and sending them the data. And then they were testing their transactions on the back end. And they actually ended up cutting it down from like a 2-month mock election. It ended up being a week, because they said once we supplied the data, they could use that and do everything they needed. They didn't need us to do anything else.
Thank you.
Diane?
Yes, sorry to backtrack for just a second. A really kind of simple question, I think. First of all, I wanna give big credit to our organization for putting together managing as many ballot styles as we need. And just to go back to that really quickly, how many did you say there are? How many different ballot styles?
At present, using the precincts that we have prior to redistricting, which is 255 precincts, you multiply that by 3 party styles, it's 765 ballot styles. Now that, of course, will change with redistricting.
Okay. Does that take into account the different languages in which it's printed?
No, because it's only printed in English and Spanish and bilingual. So okay. Both languages are on the same ballot. We don't do another ballot style for another language.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Any other question? No. Thank you, Addison. Okay, go ahead, Addison. Do you have anything else?
The only other item in my report that board members may have questions on is the outreach report. Hilberto and his team are back at doing outreach events now in person as well as virtually. And I provided a list of the events that they have done in the last 3 months.
Yes, you said that one.
That concludes my report.
Alex, yes.
Madam President, just quickly, Allison, what I saw a reference to this term voter empowerment training in the outreach section. What is that?
Hilberto, are you in the meeting?
He was.
I'm here. Hello. Good afternoon, board members. Let me take the camera off. Here I am. You want to see my lovely face? Okay. Good afternoon. Yes. Yeah, so empowerment means that encompasses everything from A to C, from voting by mail, early voting, voter maintenance, provisional voting, sample ballots. We encompass what's the entire process. We're working closely with the high schools right now. We're finalizing our voter empowerment drive, which encompasses everything that I've mentioned, and also looking at registering these students to vote and or in the recruitment of poll workers and or for those students to participate in our future vote initiative. So it's not just registering these students, it's actually teaching them about the process in Maryland.
So it's like a seminar or a course that you go through these issues and say, and tell them, this is how we do this, this is how we do that.
Yes, correct. And what we do is we work with the MCR SGA at the high school level, and then those students will assist us during the voter registration drive. So the premise is a peer-to-peer session. We provide the students with the tools. They assist staff that are present in the high schools. Because of course, you know, the students themselves will, you know, they approach their classmates quicker than they'll approach us. And then we're there to assist them if they have any questions regarding next steps, if I need to update my registration, what does it encompass as being a poll worker, et cetera. Especially the nuances between earning student service learning credits as opposed to the stipend. So the goal is that the students become field topic experts and they could assist long after we are not in the schools. We're looking at doing a 2-day in-person drive. But then once we leave the high schools to go to another high school, the SGA officers are there to field any questions, but we're always available to the SGA advisor, who's historically one of the teachers in the history department and the social studies department, that would help us. And then they have access to us.
Okay, thank you.
Any other question for Gilberto? Thank you, Gilberto.
Thank you.
Board attorney's report, Kevin.
Thank you, Madam President. We are working on MOUs with Montgomery County for right of entry agreements for early voting, as well as a right of entry agreement with Gaithersburg and with the Sandy Spring Volunteer Fire Department. So those are being circulated as drafts. We have a draft MOU that's being prepared with Rockville to use their Dropbox for the primary general election. And we had a meeting with Montgomery County Public Schools to discuss the logistics of the drop boxes and the video surveillance of each drop box and what's going to be needed to go ahead and download and preserve that video evidence. And ultimately, as we did in 2020, we're going to have to go ahead and come up with an MOU with regard to the drop boxes and when they're going to be installed and the other requirements. So all those agreements are being put in place for the primary and the general. We have all gotten an advance request for an advance determination on a petition issue. And it's the issue is a reparations task force to determine damages for those who have been the subject of racism. This was sent to me by Allison last week. Under Maryland law, this is not an appropriate issue for an advance determination on a petition because Maryland does not recognize initiative petitions. So to the extent there would be such a task force that we put together, that would be something that the county council would have to do, but you cannot force the county to put that kind of question on the ballot. And so what we will be doing is writing back to the gentleman who requested the advance determination that it is not the proper subject of a petition for referendum of the county charter. And I'll work with Allison to get that out in the next day or so. Other than that, we're just working on agreements.
Yes, Alex.
Kevin, I have a question about mail-in ballots. And this is somewhat unrelated to your report, but is third-party harvesting of mail-in ballots lawful in Maryland? Do you know?
I don't believe it is unlawful, but I think there is a bill that's being proposed right now, which I think we're going to talk about in legislation.
So I guess right now it's just not, the subject isn't addressed one way or the other in the
I don't believe it is addressed one way or the other.
Cool.
Yes, Diane.
Hi. Thanks, Kevin and Alex for that question. I'm pretty sure that I posited that question during a recent election and was told that it's okay. And I was alarmed. But you're saying it's unsettled? There's no prohibition at this point?
For what it's worth, Diane, I remember it the way you do, that current law allows I wouldn't necessarily have used the same words that Mr. Vincent used, but the current law allows some people to take other people's ballots to the drop boxes, for example.
Yeah, I mean, I guess certainly you can take other people's ballots to the drop box, and there's nothing that would there's no law that prevents ballot harvesting right now. So since there's no law that prevents it.
We're restricted in who we can give your ballot to. But you are not restricted in who you can give your ballot to take it to the post office or a Dropbox or wherever.
So if my 92-year-old mother wants me to take her ballot to the post office for her, that is, there is no law that would prevent me from doing so.
Correct.
And similarly, if an unrelated person came to your elderly relative and asked to take it in, and she said, okay, that's permissible, which would be the sort of the definition of ballot harvesting. Is that right, Kevin?
I'm not aware of any law that would prevent that. That's correct.
I cannot, though, give your mother's ballot to you. Your mother would have to give us written authority to do that.
Right. My mother wouldn't fall for that stuff, even when she has no memory left of anything. I'm quite sure that she'll hang on to her ballot. But I do understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
I do not have anything else to report.
Thank you, Kevin. Okay, now we have the new business. Start with redistricting and precinct. Who's going to talk first?
I'll start, and then Janet may very well want to sort of chime in on some of the more technical components of where we stand. We did have legislation proceed at the end of last year for part of what we need for redistricting. We have additional legislation in the General Assembly right now. Ultimately, when we overlay all of the new boundaries that are drawn for each of the jurisdictions that you conduct elections for, then your responsibility is to then take those subdivisions on the map and to divide up precincts, which typically what we will do is we will generally abide by our current precincts and make relatively minor changes in order to move the boundaries of precincts, create new boundaries, new precincts where needed, around the edges of where those boundaries are. Now, the question that we are grappling with right now is illustrated. I think, Janet, do you have at hand the map of the Kengar neighborhood that you could share? And then we can talk through the staging of how this works. I have a good illustration for you here where we have a precinct 1340, which if Janet's not able to pull it up, I will. I'm not as good at doing two things at once and pulling it up while I'm also talking about it. We have a precinct 1340, which the county council, when they took up the council redistricting, they used to have a boundary that followed along the, there you go, now you can see it on your screen. The boundary for the county council district used to follow the yellow line that you see on the map. That's the edge of our existing precinct 1340. What you see there is kind of the red and blue dotted line is a creek bed that now the county council has moved their boundary between two districts to now go along that line. And so we have voters in this precinct north of the line who have one set of jurisdictions on their ballot. And we have voters in this precinct south of that line who have a different set of jurisdictions on their ballot. If we were to merely conform to the council level redistricting as it stands right now, your only choice would be to create a new precinct solely for those voters in the southern half, that southern tip of that precinct. And you would now have two different precincts, one of the current precinct north of that stream and one of the sub part of that precinct that is now south of that stream because they would have a unique ballot style. Delegate Alcar has some legislation in the General Assembly that would move the Board of Education boundary to conform so that where the Board of Education boundary also now follows that yellow line on the map, the Board of Education boundary, if that legislation is enacted, would now be where the red and blue line is. In that case, what you will do is that you will redraw that precinct so that you simply move the line. So the voters who are south of the red and blue would now be absorbed presumably into precinct 1334. When we have successive rounds of redistricting, you simply don't know until all of the rounds of redistricting are completed, whether in a situation like this, you're gonna need to create a new precinct or whether you're going to be able to move those voters into one of the existing precincts. And so this is the type of challenge statewide that we are sort of currently watching and waiting to see how it is resolved so that then we can accomplish the changes in the voter registration database for the voters who live in that neighborhood. And that includes obviously all voters, but let's say you had a candidate who lived in that area. You know, we cannot make the change in the statewide voter registration database that will reflect where those voters are going to live until those decisions are final. And until we bring the requests to you, the proposals to you, for you to then act on to redraw precinct boundaries and give us the direction on what changes to make in the voter registration database and then what changes to in turn notify the voters of. So there's going to be a lot of very fast work that's going to occur in the coming weeks. And we anticipate being able to bring recommendations to you as early as the February meeting. Watch this spot, basically. We'll keep you posted.
What, you know, the question which I'm getting a lot, the candidates said the deadline for filing is 22 of February. How long that would take, how they would approach these changes? What do they do? They don't know where they belong.
And I understand there's been some talk potentially of moving the filing deadline. That would be a decision of the legislature that has not been made at this point either. I heard the conversation earlier about trying to provide some more sort of user-friendly information on our website about this process. And I think we can work toward that while we are waiting to be able to make the actual change in the voter registration deadline that will in turn affect both the districts that candidates live in, as well as the precincts where voters will vote and the ballots, the jurisdictions on their ballot.
David. Yes.
Thank you, Madam President. Alison, do we know how many voters there are in that area, the boundary of the yellow line and the red and blue?
Janet, do you? We have the ability to pull that information.
I'm guessing around 50. Around 50, I think.
Isn't that area
the
park?
Well, it abuts the park. You have to access it from Pliers Mill Road. It's a historically black area. It's been part of 1340 for many years. That was my precinct a long time ago.
So is the houses in those park area inside the park?
No, it's not. It's outside the park.
Okay.
The green is park, but it's outside
the
park.
Well, I would be interested if we have any information about the numbers there, and then
the numbers, yes.
Yeah, and then my other question is, I remember that we got a fairly extensive proposal from Delegate Carr about precincts in the Kensington area, and Alison, you mentioned that he has legislation about this particular area to try and match it with the school or the school board district. Do we know whether the redistricting plan, which I believe has passed one of the houses of the legislature, do we know what it does with this area? Because that could also affect what we have to do. And does anyone remember how this relates to what Delegate Carr was telling us before?
This was one of the areas that Delegate Carr had identified. And I believe that moving the Board of Education, the Board of Education boundary, I believe is the only other one in this area right here that would affect our current precincts. I have not yet personally, we have had Louisa Warner, our GIS specialist, has been doing the analysis of these. I actually have not personally eyeballed the other precincts the delegate Carr had identified, but we'll certainly be doing that prior to the February meeting.
Yeah, my only thought is that if it turns out that, and he's probably on top of it, would be my guess, but if it turns out that area, we would hate to have it count. I know that in general, we don't want to have a precinct that only has a small number of people in them for a whole variety of reasons relating to resources, privacy, you know, all kinds of reasons. But we would hate to have, out of, four different types of districts, have one of them end up requiring us to have a separate precinct if there's a way to avoid that for such a small group.
Thank you. Alex.
Thank you, Madam President. Allison, do we currently, today, have a list or a map that shows which precincts are in which of the new redrawn council districts?
No.
Janet, can you speak to that?
No, we don't have that yet. We can't do it yet.
And the reason is?
Because of that little area right there.
Well, I mean, just leaving that out for the moment, do we have a list of all the precincts? Which one?
We have a sample map that Louise did. We do have one that we've been using internally that we can share with the board.
Thank you. Yes, you would like to have them.
Yeah, we can share that one with you.
Can I ask a question about that? If you share that with the board, are we allowed to share it with others, or is that still an internal draft that we're... Because when you say you're waiting for about that area, is it because we're waiting for action by the council?
Or we're waiting for the delegate Carr's bill so that we can incorporate that little area into the other precinct.
And okay. Madam President, I was actually just slipped a note that Delegate Carr's on the meeting if you have any questions.
Because we cannot wait too long. Let me see, well, Ami talk, then we'll talk to Delegate Carr. Okay. Ami, yes, because her hand is up for a long time.
Can I finish answering Mr. Naiman's question now? The map, we were going to give it out to the public. We had actually told the public it's available until we found that little discrepancy. And now it's up in the air. So,
but is the map of council districts? Because it sounds like the council.
It's the map of the council district. So,
because it sounds like the council districts are not what's changing with Delegate Carr's bill. It sounds like the school board districts are what would be changing with Delegate Carr's bill.
Right.
But it just shows 1340 as a whole thing, and it shouldn't be. I don't have a problem with it, but it's Allison's call.
Okay.
We can put something up.
Thank you. Anything else? Ami, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, ask if this is the only issue in Montgomery County.
No.
How many other sorts of similar problems do we have?
We haven't. Louise Warner, who is the GIS specialist, she has been taking the maps and overlaying them into precincts. I think with one of them, I think it was the legislative, the proposed map, she found like six precincts are split. She said congressional, there's more, but she was just doing the analysis right now. Mm-hmm. So we don't have final numbers. And you know, she's doing them quick just to see what potential issues there are. And so we really haven't dived really deep into it to actually look. This is like high level, she's overlaying and say, you know, six precincts were split with the legislative changes, but the congressional, she said it was much more.
Okay.
Ami, your hand is up.
Yeah, any no, questions? I'm done now.
Okay, that's... thank you. Any other question? Delegate Carr, if you are there, can you speak up, please?
Yes, Madam Chair, good afternoon, everyone. Happy to answer any questions if I can do that.
Board member, do you have a question?
I have a question, Delegate Carr. If your legislation on the school board district passes, would that be consistent with now all the districts, the council, the legislative, et cetera, so that we can move this area to the other precinct?
Yes, Commissioner Naaman, thank you for that great question. So yes, the with this legislation, MC 26-22, it would conform the school board district boundary in that area to the county council district boundary in that area, and it will avoid the creation of an island precinct consisting only of Kengar. So that is the purpose of the bill, and it will also, I think, fulfills the school board's desire to have their boundaries mirror the high school cluster boundaries. So the hearing for the bill will be on Friday. It's an emergency bill, and the bill could also be used as a vehicle if there are other small tweaks needed to, you know, prevent the creation of these tiny precincts. That bill provides a vehicle to do that.
Is there a legislative district boundary near there, or is that not a factor for which precinct this neighborhood goes in?
That is not a factor. The legislative district map that was passed by the Senate there are no changes in District 18, and this is sort of in the middle, the heart of District 18, so that would not be part of the equation.
Okay, thank you.
Any other question? Yes, Alan.
Delegate Carr, about how many voters are in Kengar?
Yes, Commissioner, that's a great question. I think you are correct when you said about 50 voters. It is a small number. I think in the county council's report, you know, they had a more precise number, but I think you are correct. The population might be, you know, something like 300, but the voters would probably be closer to 50.
Thank you.
Any other question? Thank you. Thank you, Dan Carr. We appreciate your input. Okay. Any more? Yes, Diane.
Yes, not for Delegate Carr. Thank you very much. But maybe for Janet and Allison. Thanks for offering to get a map up. But could you also get us a list of the precincts in each district?
Yes.
All right. And that'll be sent to us?
Yes. You're going to have to give us a couple of days.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you, okay. Janet. Thank you so much, Janet. That will help us. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any other question regarding this matter? No more? Okay, then. We go to another new business. Janet, after I talked to you regarding the judges, the site which we have, our board site, only said to apply this application, doesn't say anything when is the training, a little bit detailed information. Is it possible you can change it and tell the one that want to be judged to apply as soon as possible, and then the training is such a date that they'll be prepared? It doesn't say anything right now.
The training is on there. It's not on the page you were looking. It's a little further down because I was actually working on that today, the updates from Aisha. It's out there and it says March to be determined, the exact date, 2022. But we didn't tell the judges to sign up yet because we haven't done the official kickoff. That's not till February because we have to do the quiz in the system and have the online training. So because once they sign up, they automatically get an email that says, now do your quiz. Once they do the quiz, they get an automatic email that says, now do your online training. When they finish that, they get another email that says, okay, now go sign up for your in-person training. So that's why the official kickoff is February 11th. That gives us time to get the quiz up, the online training ready, and everything ready. But some judges have already figured it out and are signing up because we can see when they go through the system.
Any other, yes, Diane.
So Janet, are you saying that if people send in a an interest right now of signing up, they'll be told they have to wait?
No, we'll process it.
Oh,
these are the people that are already in the system. And what we do is they're in the system. When we roll over to a new election, we set them all to pending. They're not active. We send out an email blast that says, okay, we're kicking off the election. We need you to renew your application because it's a law. They have to renew every election. And once they renew, that's when they start getting the automatic emails. Your next step is this, your next step is that. So, but if you send in a paper application or whatever, we're going to process it. We're not going to hold it.
All right.
They're constantly processing back there right now. They got a lot to process.
Thanks for the hard work.
Anybody else? No more questions regarding this matter? All right then. Any other new business we have to discuss? Yes, Ami.
Naheed, Madam Chairman, I am wondering if we're going to do anything about the conundrum between when we can finalize the precincts and when the candidates have to file their candidacies, because it seems to me that the dates are in conflict.
Melissa?
And I cannot remember the exact dates under discussion off the top of my head, but I know that in a hearing last week, I believe the state administrator actually requested an extension of the candidate filing deadline. So I know that there is some very, very serious attention to extending the deadline. Right now, of course, when candidates do file, they are given information that is notifying them that the district are subject to change, and that effectively, if a candidate files in a district, they don't need to re-renew once redistricting occurs. They are filed as a candidate in the district where they reside. And so when their voter record changes to say they're no longer in District A, they're now in District B, their candidacy will be recognized in District B rather than District A. I do recognize that while generally speaking, candidates are following this and have an understanding of where their houses are going to be once these lines changed, everybody wants that information now. We will work to try to get some more user-friendly information up on our website to help communicate about that. But I also know that there is an active conversation going on about the prospect of actually changing the candidate filing deadline as well.
Do we have this information in our site? When people go to our site, they have this information?
We should do that. We'll work on that.
Right. Okay, thank you. Yes, David.
I was just following up on Ami's question. Is that something that we may want to discuss as part of the discussion of legislation when we get to that? Because I gather that in order to, we don't have the authority to change the filing deadline, but we certainly can add our two cents to the conversation if we think that there's not sufficient time for people to know kind of where they stand. I would also point out that it is not unprecedented for people to run for U.S. House of Representatives without living in a district, so that by putting people into districts where they live is not an automatic answer to this question.
But that's true of Congress, not of the state legislature, though.
Right, that's what I'm saying. But the filing deadline that's coming up includes Congress, and now the congressional redistricting is pretty much done, although subject to legal challenge, of course, but I'm just saying that I can understand how it would be better for any candidates deciding what they want to do to know what boundaries they're operating under.
Okay. Yes, Alice.
Just a reminder that we also had committees as a new business topic.
So, Madam President, do you want to take up legislation next and then committees?
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay. The report that I provided, I had actually copied and pasted the entire list of all of the bills that come up when you do a search for elections and voting bills in the legislature. And then in my narrative, I had really just highlighted the bills, primarily the bills that are up for hearing on Wednesday. I know there was some discussion among board members about the prospect of taking positions or testifying at Wednesday's hearing. First off, I just want to let you know that, well, first off, just to cover what those bills are, there are one bill that has been in focus for us, there's been a lot of conversation about, is Senate Bill 163. I don't know if Senator Kagan is on with us today, but this is one of Senator Kagan's bills to allow us to be able to open the absentee ballot envelopes early like we did last time. There has been some back and forth over sort of some technical language about the distinction between canvassing and tabulating, and there's some sort of definitional questions about what exactly we would do beforehand. I understand Senator Kagan's concern is that we not print election results prior to election day. And so there's been some sort of nuancy conversations going on among the election officials about that. The other open question, which I understand is sort of the subject of some wrangling among legislators right now, is the period of time over which you would be able to conduct the canvass. Senator Kagan's bill would allow for ballots to be opened beginning the day after the voter registration deadline, so 20 days before Election Day. But I know that there's been some other legislators who have been concerned that you not be conducting the canvass during early voting. And so I know there's some conversations going on about the substance of that bill. And I believe the Maryland Association of Election Officials is planning to testify on Wednesday in support of that bill with an amendment to clarify this question about the definition of tabulating and what we would be doing before Election Day and what we would need to change practices to hold off on. I do not know what the current status is of discussions about the date, but that is open as well. So I don't know if Senator Kagan is on. I know she often is when we're talking about her bills, or Madam President, if you've got board members' questions you want to move to on that bill.
Yes, but let me, Alex, yes, you have a question, Alex?
Allison, do you, just from your own experience, do you have an understanding of what canvassing means and what tabulation means, even if we may not know exactly what, you know, the drafters of the bill intended? Do you have an understanding of what those mean? Because I'm not sure I understand the difference.
Where the question arises right now is that the way that we actually handled this, and there's a distinction between the technology that's used in the larger counties and the technologies that's used in the smaller counties. We use a high-speed scanner for our absentee ballots and for our provisional ballots. And in many of the smaller counties, they use the exact same equipment for the absentee and provisional canvasses that they use out in the polls on Election Day. When you can't reuse the equipment that is used at the polls on Election Day without printing results. So you can't take a machine and day after day after day be scanning results and then have separate batches of ballots to be able to do an audit of, you can't say take, you know, one day's ballots and scan them in that machine, shut it down, and then start it back up again to do a separate batch of the next day's ballots. You have to keep that equipment open until you run the results tape. And so there are a variety of circumstances is where we actually do print a batch worth of election results right now. And then we just keep that under lock and key until Election Day, when we actually upload and release that data. And I believe that Senator Kagan's concern is to try to find a way where we would prohibit the printing of those election results prior to election day. And so it's a matter of both the legal definition and the technical practice for how that would be done across the different kinds of equipment that we use. That's the subject of the wrangling right now.
Well, so when you scan, is that canvassing? But when you print the results tape, that's tabulating? Or
I think that's the concept that people are trying to get toward, but we've got to kind of work out administrative procedure as well as legal definitions.
Do you understand Senator Kagan to be proposing that this be allowed to begin on election day, but before the polls close?
I don't remember how that piece of it is phrased. I got to check.
Okay, thank you.
Alan,
the first thing, I tried to find a definition of tabulation in the election code and in Comar. I couldn't find a definition, but the closest I could find in Comar, section 33.11.04.10, ballot tabulation, quote, "The tabulation of the ballots shall follow their removal from the return envelopes without unreasonable delay," end quote. Suggest scanning and therefore counting, but not necessarily publishing.
Alex, your hand is up.
Sorry, I didn't.
Okay.
Question. Yeah, it's, I mean, Alan, I guess the best I could say is that, yes, we kind of need to be very clear, because tabulation could mean counting, or it could mean counting and then summing everything up. I don't know, but.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The legislation should make it clear.
It's really not defined at this point.
So that's the bill that the Maryland Association of Election Officials, I understand, to be testifying in support with an amendment on Wednesday. After I saw the back and forth among board members, I actually, just because the deadline was 45 minutes ago, I signed up to testify for information only on these bills. And so, you know, if the board wants to take a position of, I would assume it would be either support or support with amendment, then I can communicate that on your behalf, or, you know, whatever you want to do as a body. But it is certainly, the hearing on that bill is on Wednesday.
David, yes.
Thank you, Madam President. I had a couple of thoughts. One is that I'd be curious to know what my colleagues think should be the dividing line, because I agree that tabulation is not clear, and it sounds like Mayo agrees with that as well. My own thought is that this is not that different than what happens with early voting counting, which is that that is done, I believe it starts on the morning of election day. I don't know exactly when it starts, but it's definitely not released until all the polls are closed. I'm not aware of there ever having been an issue with that scenario in the more than 10 years that we've had early voting. So one thought would be to allow it to be scanned, but not allow the results to be published, if that is if that's the dividing line that people are concerned about. I think the real issue as to why the legislation might be worthy of our support is just that the number of ballots to process is going to, definitely be a lot. The public is very interested, and the candidates even more so, in getting results very quickly. And I don't know about the rest of you, but I know one of the most frequent questions I get from people when they find out about our work is they find it surprising the number of days that we have to spend after election day. And the question I get most often is, isn't the election over? And of course, it's not until all the ballots have been counted. But I'd be interested in knowing what, I know that the board, I believe that that Jim appeared in Annapolis in person to lobby people about allowing us to open our absentee ballots or vote by mail ballots, whatever you want to call them, before election day, because this is like a huge problem for Montgomery County that other people, you know, people in smaller jurisdictions don't have the same, you know, the same issue. We are usually the last to report because we have the most to do. So I think it's certainly worthy of our consideration. Thank you.
Ami.
My question, Allison, is do you know the content of the amendment that's being proposed? You talked about they were going to support it with amendment.
I think there's been a variety of different people with ideas of how this ought to be amended, and I'm not sure that either the sponsor or Mayo has really come to a clear resolution on this one yet.
Okay, well, that might clarify some of the issues about definition.
Anyway, yes, Diane, you have a resolution for
me. Yeah, I think Alan had his up ahead of me.
Yeah, thank you. Madam Chair, I have a motion that our board support Senate Bill 163 with the amendment that we can scan ballots before Election Day and going back as far as 20 days before the election, and the proviso is that no one would be able to publish the results until after the polls are closed on Election Day.
You mean general election, right?
Primary or general?
Yeah, it's good to say that.
I think I would second that motion, but I would want to get a clarification if the 20 days before the election is the same as 8 days before early voting that is in the bill now.
I would say 8 days before the early voting.
They're the same date, yeah.
Okay, I would second Alan's motion.
And I actually just had a little text exchange with a colleague that I believe that's consistent with where the Maryland Association of Election Officials is going with this.
Yes, Diane.
Before I get to that, it mentions SB 163, a deadline. It would allow absentee ballots to be canvassed anytime after the voter registration deadline. Excuse me, what is that date?
Is that 30 days before the election?
21. I think of it in terms of the voter registration deadline because that was the concern, was that we get past the voter registration deadline and the likelihood that somebody might change their party or that we would have address changes that would come in at that point, that would affect the ballot. That's how this date come about. But the way that it is written in the legislation, it's 8 days before early voting. And if you do the math both ways, you reach the same date.
Okay. I do not support canvassing ballots before the beginning of early voting.
What do you propose?
Early voting, the date of early voting.
It was 8 days later.
Which would be 8 days later than is suggested in 163.
Any other?
When are mail-in ballots sent out to people, and when do they start to come in?
They're mailed out first to overseas military voters 45 days prior. Domestic ballots are normally mailed out about 42 days or so prior, after the military and overseas ballots have gone out.
In response to a request, right?
Yeah. And the you know, there's the discussion about early voting. I hear, you know, Diane's concern. There was a sort of the opposite concern that was voiced by some members of the legislature, that they were concerned that we should not be simultaneously canvassing and allowing ballots to vote, or allowing voters to cast their ballots during early voting. And so that's where this discussion about potentially letting us canvass before early voting and then stopping once live voting occurs. I think there's a lot of different opinions on that.
The other question I would have is, would this affect when we as the Board of Canvassers would have to meet?
The my expectation would be that you would do as you've done in the past, if we where we would convene, and Kevin may want to weigh in this, but I think we would convene at the the start time that's designated, and then you would be able to recess and come back into session during that allowable period, aside from perhaps right at the beginning, that you wouldn't have a command performance to canvass on any set date. It's when you have the flexibility to canvass.
But meaning not before the Thursday after the general election. Is that right?
No.
What you meant, or no?
No? No, it would be earlier. So, I mean, when you think about this, I think you have to look at it sort of globally as to who would be doing what work. So you have voter registration, which is Boris and Michelle that would be doing the canvassing. And then you've got Janet's team that's doing the scanning. And for all practical purposes, the scanning is not going to really begin until closer to the election itself. And why I say that is because Janet's team is going to be busy setting up early voting sites and making sure early voting is getting done. So what happened in 2020 was Boris and Michelle, among others, were at Plum Guard. They were starting to do the canvassing. The ballots would be opened. They'd be put in boxes. They'd flatten out, which actually is better because it makes it easier for it to scan through the 850 high scanner. But the actual scanning sort of lagged behind the opening of the ballots because of other operational issues that needed to be addressed.
Any other idea?
I think Alan's got his hand up.
Everybody hands up.
Alan. Yeah. As a reminder, in the primary in 2020, the State Board of Elections said that we can start the canvassing 11 days before the primary. And then in the presidential election, the State Board authorized us to start canvassing 33 days before the election. We actually started after that. But we were allowed to start 33 days before. In the primary, in Montgomery County, we had over 260,000 people. Over 260,000 people voted by mail, 4,500 voted in person. That was at the worst of the pandemic. In the presidential election in November, 348,744 of the 518,000 non-provisional voters were cast by mail. 67%. So you're talking about hundreds of thousands of votes cast by mail, and think about the pressure upon staff to try to complete that and give some results on election day without this amendment. I think it's terrible.
Diane.
And just thank you, Madam President. Was David's hand up before mine?
No. Oh,
okay. You were first.
Okay, thank you. I want to add my reasoning to this discussion, and that is, I believe in the sanctity of the vote, how important it is to our democratic process, and how critical it is to have well-informed voters. I think if you start opening these things, what we have early voting, which has opened up voting possibilities well before election day. And the further back we open these, tally them, it just realistically expands further the time frame before an election day. And I just am philosophically opposed to extending that further and further out before. And to Alan's comments, I am hoping that the heavy volume of absentee ballots was a one-off, and that the pandemic with which we were dealing at that time is not going to be happening every 2 years, and that people will go back to voting in person, which is really the most secure way to make sure that your vote is accurately counted. And I implore anybody listening to share that with all the voters they know, to reduce the amount of mail-in ballots, which would then not make this having to do it earlier and earlier just to get it done, that in-person voting is the best way to go.
Thank you, Diane. David?
Well, a couple of thoughts. First off, my understanding is that it's difficult for us to generalize based on 2020. There were a number of things that were unusual about 2020, but one of them that I want to remind my colleague Diane about is that Governor Hogan authorized the early opening of ballots in order to address because the normal state law, of course, does not, which is why we're talking about this legislation, in order to address the very large volume of vote by mail ballots. We do not know exactly how it's going to shake out for the next election. The next election is not very long from now. The next election is basically less than 6 months from now. The election day is more than 6 months from now, but you know, the time period we're talking about for whether we're going to start counting ballots, early voting, vote by mail, is coming up soon. I don't pretend to have a crystal ball on the pandemic, but thus far, we have not seen it disappear. So while I also enjoy the experience of voting in person, clearly there are lots of reasons for lots of people to vote in different ways. I think our job is to be as efficient as we can with all of them. And that's essentially why I'm, you know, in support of this motion. I was a relative latecomer to the idea of opening ballots before Election Day for fear of leaks of results. I would share the concern of, if that's the sponsor's concern or others, about not, you know, definitely not, no word about the results should be out until the polls close on Election Day. On the other side of that, of course, is that we really didn't have that as a problem in 2020. We didn't have that as a problem for early voting in any of our previous elections. We really didn't have any evidence of problems with the vote in Maryland in terms of the kind of security questions that you're talking about. We didn't have those kinds of questions in Maryland in 2020. But when it comes to when we're going to meet as a board, I don't think we are talking about being on the same schedule as we were before. I think we can assume that we will not have to be present for the canvass before early voting, because that was a special rule for 2020. I think there would have to be another special rule for us not to be there. Otherwise, I believe that a quorum of the board would be required to be there for canvasses. That might be a clarification that we'd want to get. But I would think that that we would have to have at least a quorum present in order to do that. But I think this would be a major benefit to the voters, to the candidates, to everyone, to get results, in a reasonable amount of time, without rushing the vote count, which, as we know from experience, you can't rush the vote count. So anyway, thank you.
Thank you, David. I remember you simply said you object to that one. Any other? You don't see any hand up. Remember, there's a motion on the floor. I guess who seconded? You said
David.
I seconded it. Alan made it.
Okay. So anybody want to amend that motion?
Could you please restate it?
You said. Lisa, can you?
Hello, board members, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so I have the motion by Mr. Danoff to support Senate Bill 163 with the amendment to scan ballots before Election Day as far back as 8 days or 20 days before Election Day, with no published votes to be disclosed until the polls close on Election Day.
Yes.
I would like to offer an amendment to the motion that the terms tabulation and canvas all be appropriately defined in the legislation.
That's fine with me. If you want to, I'll take a friendly amendment to that.
Why don't you just second it?
Yeah, okay.
You seconded, Alan?
Yeah.
Alan seconded Lisa. Yes, Diane. Your hand is, excuse me. Ami, your hand is still up. You have more?
Sorry.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Madam President. Just for further edification, what is the current law?
So Diane, let me sort of chime in here. First of all, I will say that the board historically, going back since I've been involved with the board, has actively advocated for being able to begin canvassing before Election Day. And let me explain to you why. You know, put aside the pandemic and put aside, you know, everything else, it's not atypical in Montgomery County to get anywhere from 25 to 40,000 absentee vote by mail ballots. Then you put on top of that ballots that we need to duplicate because of online, you know, vote, you know, the ballots you can go ahead and get and print out and then mail in. So then you have that manual duplication process. Then you have ballots that are sometimes that are not just, you know, vote by mail. You've got provisionals, and those can be in full, but they can also be in parts. They also have to be duplicated. So there's a very labor intensive part of this that has to be done, and it all has to be done before the audit's done, and it all has to be done before certification occurs. So there's a tremendous amount of pressure on the board and on the staff to begin that process after the election. So, you know, it's ultimately the board's call, but the reality is that this would be a good, in my opinion, from an election standpoint, would be a good thought moving forward as how we handle the canvas and how we canvas ballots, that it would be a step clearly in the right direction. Because I think if you want to do this properly, then you really need to go ahead and have the time to go ahead and make sure you're doing everything rather than sort of throwing things together, you know, because we've got a certification date and we have members of, you know, our elected body and our Board of Education that are all getting sworn in and we haven't certified the results. So in 2020, this was clearly by regulation by the state, we were permitted to do this. I think this bill is just an extension of the fact that I think it went well. And it's what I think a lot of jurisdictions have gone to. That doesn't mean you post results or you know, that anyone knows what the results are, but it allows the staff to the flexibility to at least begin doing the things that will be necessary to get the canvas done in a timely fashion. And it gives both the candidates and our voters, you know, more votes that are counted on election night that get ultimately tabulated with, you know, in-person voting and early voting, and then the numbers that we have up through, you know, the close of the polls.
Okay, well, thank you. That, I appreciate that. What is the current date?
The day after the election.
2 days after the election.
2 days after the election.
The statute is 8 a.m. on the Wednesday following the election, and COMAR, the regulation, says the Thursday after the election.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's Diane, it's it's the Thursday after the election would be the first absentee one or vote by mail one on canvas.
So
Kevin, remember how many absentee votes we had last election? Remember it was like 200 plus?
It was like 350,000 ballots.
350 absentee ballots, yeah, okay, thank you.
If this is moved up that early, is there also provision for the public viewing of the canvassing of the votes?
Yes, the public's allowed to attend the canvass, and I think David raises a good point. I don't know there's any real assurance that the board's not going to have a greater role in overseeing the actual canvassing. You know, 2020 was an anomaly. You know, where we basically everyone logged on by Zoom and did it that way. I mean, I filled in for Prince George's County's board attorney and their Councilmanic 8 race. And I'll tell you, I mean, they did everything by mail, but the canvas was, the whole board was there for the canvas. Okay. So.
One thing I'd like to point out to the board members too, just looking ahead and you know, June, it's not as tight, but for the November election, we're actually losing a week this year because the first Tuesday after the first Monday, the first Tuesday is the first. So with November 8th being election day and November 10th being the day that we would normally begin the canvass, we actually have exactly 3 weeks before we have county offices scheduled to be sworn in on December 1st. So we have a very tight timetable this upcoming general election.
Alex?
Madam President, so if I could just get clarification from Kevin, when did we begin scanning absentee ballots in 2020?
Janet could give you the exact date. We started the canvass though a couple weeks before election day. And basically what we did, Alex, is we took over a Plumgar Recreation Center, which is down the road from the Board of Elections, and they set up the canvass there. We could have started earlier than we actually did. We just didn't have enough ballots in to really make it worth doing, have everyone up there. But it was a couple weeks before the election.
And what do you think was the reason why we had so many? Was it because of the drop boxes? Was that it?
Well, I think it was because of the pandemic. People didn't want to vote in person. Right. But, you know, you recall from your time on the board before the pandemic, there can be a lot of ballots.
Yeah, no, there can be. I'm not necessarily opposed to conceptually to beginning the canvass at an earlier date. I don't know if, you know, 20 days before or you know, 30 days before the election is the right time. I'm a little concerned that we're talking about, I haven't even read SB 163. I don't know, I haven't seen any text of Mayo's proposed amendment. And even Alan's proposal, unless I see it in writing and how it affects the language, I think it's a little problematic for us to be agreeing to legislation with conditions when we haven't written it out and see what the language looks like. That's my concern. But I don't have a vote on this anyway, so.
Yes, David.
Well, first off, I want to speak in favor of Ami's amendment. I'm a believer that the statute should be as specific as possible on most subjects, let alone on a voting subject as important as this one. So I don't know that I would want to specifically ask them to define tabulate, because I'm not sure that's the word that they should use, but because I'm not sure that by definition it's specific enough. But I would want it to be very explicit in the statute as to what it is they're allowing us to do and what they're not allowing us to do. I ordinarily, as a result of wanting to put things into legislation and wanting to be very precise, I ordinarily would have a similar concern to Alex's about supporting something in concept rather than supporting some specific language. But I will say that there's clearly a lot of different, very smart people with a lot of knowledge about elections who are going to be working on what the language of that legislation should say. So I think it does make sense for us to talk about concepts here. And I think that Alan's motion, as amended by Ami, does do that. It makes clear that we are supporting the idea of starting earlier, the 12 days before early voting, I believe it is, while also indicating that we want the bill to be clarified to specify what exactly we're allowed to do. And I understand Alan's motion to be, we're allowed to scan, we're not allowed to publish results, which is, you know, consistent with our past practice. And then the final thing I was going to say is that I remember attending the October opening of the absentee canvas. I believe it was in early October, like roughly the 6th or 7th of October in 2020. I attended. Board members were not required to attend. I attended just because I thought it made sense for us to have both, you know, both parties represented at that meeting, and to thank our canvassers. But I'm pretty sure that it was early October when we did that. And I think that our staff did an excellent job. Thank you.
I attended
October 6th. That one too. David.
Yes, thank you. Not Ami.
Okay. I think I was next. Well, that's exactly why I asked for a clarification on what the proposed amendments are going to be to the bill, and why I suggest that we have clear definitions on this. I have no problem with supporting the concept. I have a problem with supporting a particular number of days, unless that's specified with the rationale as to what can be done on which day. And I have a problem if there are unknown amendments to supporting a bill that is going to be amended by unknown amendments. So I would be reluctant to support the motion that's currently on the floor, even with my amendment.
Diane.
Thank you, Madam President. Since I am a voting member, I want to attach my allegiance to the comments that were made by Mr. Vinson, and I want to thank him. And I, for those reasons, in addition to my philosophical not wanting to just keep extending the time to vote, can't support something that is not, I can't support something that I don't, that is not there. I don't want to vote in concept on something that's actually got a bill name. And to agree with everything Ami just said, until I can see what it is, I don't want to support it.
So, Madam President, I wonder, I apologize, I will sort of because allow Alex, the board Alex, to yes, follow Alex, its process.
You do. Alex, go ahead. Then you do.
And appreciate Ms. Dillon's comments about what the concerns I raised. I guess conceptually, again, if the scanning were to begin, I might be okay with that. I guess, is it possible to scan things? But then I don't know how the technology works, Alan, but I'm assuming that you scan and the scanner is sort of has a count inside of it. But unless you tell it to, you know, do the count, tell me what the count is, nobody knows what the count is. Even though the ballot has been counted, the tabulation, if we assume that means summing up the counts, hasn't, you know, you have to take affirmative action to say, tabulate, tell me what the sum of all the ballots you have scanned and counted is. And if all we're doing is scanning, you know, again, conceptually, I might be okay with that. But it's, you know, without these kind of definitions, that's what I really have trouble with.
I think you're correct that the machine has votes in it. When you go to vote in early voting at the end of the day, there are votes put onto thumb drives, and we don't know what's on those thumb drives until they're plugged in and there's a printout. So the same thing goes with canvassing early. When you start to scan ballots early, you don't know the results until you give it that command. I think Janet could probably tell us more about that, to give it the command to spit out the results and the counts.
And we didn't do that in 2020 until when?
Well, the results weren't published. Maybe Janet can deal with that as far as the timing.
Meaning when was the tabulation, if we assume that means the summing up?
The scanning counts. Began but before the election, didn't it, Janet?
Maybe Alison can answer that question.
We started scanning. They started opening the ballots October 6th. We did not start scanning until around the 20th because we still had equipment to prepare for early voting and election day. Once we finished early voting setup, we got to do the election day poll books. So once we finished those, we started scanning. And because we used a high-speed scanner, every night we cannot let the vote set like they do early voting because the file may get corrupted. We download those votes every night from every scanner. The point is, do we upload it to the state, to the ERM network, or do we hold it? If we hold it, we gotta label those sticks by day, by time, and then when it's time for us to upload it, we gotta do it in a specific order, or if we mess up in uploading, we gotta clear it and start again, uploading the sticks. So that's the issue. I think the issue is more if Senator Kagan wants us to be able to print those daily results. That's what we're thinking is her problem, but we're not sure.
Are you saying that you don't print those daily results?
Yes, we do. At this point, we do.
You do print them.
Right, but if we change the process, we have to hold those sticks, which causes a major issue. But it's possible. We can do it.
Who has access to those daily results, or who did the last time we did this?
Good question.
Me and Lisa Jones. She prints them out, and to be honest, I don't even look. I just sign the paper. She punches a hole in it, and we file it away in a binder in the server room, and nobody looks at them until if there's a problem when we go do when we're doing clear ballot or doing our final tabulation, we may look back at them. But when we're doing our manual audit, that's when we really look at them because we have to pull the audit by day.
And it's an artifact for the audit trail. And that's I think, and I'm not certain, Madam President or Kevin, if you have a hard stop on aspects of this discussion. I know you have other issues to address and a couple of executive sessions. I wonder, just to throw a few other options on the table, and the board can obviously do, you know, whatever you want to do. But another option on some of these detailed pieces is for the board certainly has you may want to articulate your sort of principles or position and perhaps defer to the Maryland Association of Election Officials on some of the detailed pieces that they're working through.
Okay, Alison. Yes, David.
Well, I would just like to express my concern about the idea that we support the concept, think that the legislation needs amendments, think we know what we want the amendments to say, but they haven't been proposed yet into language, and then are going to oppose taking a position on the bill, its concept, even with the idea that it needs amendments, because we don't have the specific language in front of us. Because the way the legislative process works, there's going to be a hearing on Wednesday, and your options are, you support it with amendments. You don't have to say what the specific amendments are. You can say it needs to be amended to do X, Y, or Z. Or you oppose it, or you're neutral. But the idea that something that benefits our county perhaps more than any other, on which the board has literally lobbied in person before, under the same party leadership that we have now, the idea that we would not support it because we don't know the exact wording they're going to end up with The sponsors don't know the exact wording they're going to end up with. The committee doesn't know the exact wording they're going to end up with. They're consulting with us. They're giving us the opportunity to give them our thoughts. So if we think, if we agree as a board, which I don't know whether we do or we don't, or perhaps a majority of the board, but if we agree as a majority of the board that we think that there should be an opportunity to start counting votes earlier, we can decide whether we're okay with the number of days that the legislation picked as the number of days, or whether we just want to say as a concept, we agree with it. And if we agree that we don't have a problem with scanning, but we do have a problem with publishing, it seems to me that this is our opportunity to influence the process. And if we are going to wait for the exact language, it will be too late for us to have any meaningful input. So I would urge all of you, consistent with your, you know, your thoughts and principles and what you think, you know, the answer should be, is let's figure out if there is some concept here where a majority agrees. And let's tell the legislature that, because we would be doing a great service to our, you know, to our county. Thank you.
Diane.
I think, Alan, were you ahead of me?
Go ahead. I'll come back to me after you finish.
Okay. I thank you, Mr. Naiman. I appreciate and agree with much of what David said. And just to let the board know and all others, I am sensitive to the amount of work it is, having been through a presidential election with this board and just, you know, the historic number of absentee ballots that we processed in just incredible fashion. And it's the best, I think, county elections board, certainly in the state, that I've seen operate, just because of what they've done, what they can achieve. So I'm absolutely sensitive to all that, and I have become more sensitized to it during this discussion. But I think voting on a bill right now is a reach too far for me, for all the reasons I mentioned, with the fact that I can't read what it is. I do not want to attach my personal support to something that is a concept, and to say that I support a concept, I just don't think it's warranted right now, when we started the whole discussion in the framework of supporting SB 163. Thank you.
I don't know whether Alan was next or Ami, or Alex was now. So you guys, which one was before? Alan was
Alan
or Ami?
Okay, I'm almost done here. Okay, I am putting into the chat box maybe an alternative motion for your review here. And I don't know about the rules of procedure here, but the point is, this is putting into language that I hope you would agree to, that would allow the local boards to open and process mailed in ballots and scan them, but not publish them until the election is over on election day. And to define the terms that are important here.
Thank you, Ms. Allen. Ami.
Okay, I think this is a pretty good start. I would actually take out the reference to the specific bill, and I would correct it to say to begin processing rather than gin. I mean, you know, I'd like a martini right now, but not quite yet. And I would just say that the Montgomery County Board of Elections would support a bill to permit blah, blah, blah. To begin processing, and then I would support this statement. And I would just say processing, because it's, as Kevin noted, the processing is different for the vote web-based, by mail.
Web-based ballots. The web-based ballots have to be copied over.
Yes. So to just process, and the processing is different for different things.
Yes. You're changing your amendment, right?
Well, and Alan's changing his motion. And I think this is a better motion. Okay. But I would take out the bill number.
Yeah, especially after Gina and Tanya. Okay. Alex. Alex.
Well, yeah, I think this is getting closer to something that I think I probably could support if I was voting. But I think, yeah, I totally agree that we should probably take out the reference to the specific bill. But why not, instead of, say, processing, to be, you know, to begin opening absentee ballot envelopes, to begin scanning, and to begin the hand duplication process, but you know, without any authorization to begin tabulating or summing results or uploading results, something like that.
If you made it uploading results, I would support what you just said, Alex. I like the idea of being specific about what we would propose to allow.
Yes.
Okay. I would certainly buy that.
Right. Yeah, that's true.
So, you know, Kevin, could you write up what we think we just agreed to and then put it on the chat box and we can see if everyone agrees?
Thank you.
You're muted, Kevin.
Alex, your hand is up. You want to talk?
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I was going to lower my hand. Okay. Maybe the better thing to do is procedurally is to do a second degree amendment to, you know, to bang out this language.
Okay, Kevin, can you put something together?
Sure.
While Kevin is talking, yes, you want to just sit tight and let him type fast, or you want to move on to other topics?
Before we move on to other topics, the bill hearing is about a specific bill.
Right.
We need to testify at a hearing about a specific bill.
No, we don't.
Yes. Well, we do if we want to testify at all. And no, there's no gun to our head that we have to do anything on this. But if we want to influence the process, I understand the desire by some members of the board not to specifically support the legislation by number, but I guess it just needs to be. I have to think about what the options are that the legislature gives for this kind of a situation. We are essentially supporting concepts that are related to the legislation without supporting the legislation. And I just wanted to make sure we get that straight, and that we do everything, you know, in a way that will get them to listen.
Go ahead,
Alex, and then Diane.
I think what I would say to David is that, we can certainly express support for the spirit or the concept of what SB 163, what we understand it's trying to accomplish, but I can't believe they wouldn't let us testify on, you know, the specific language or, you know, restrictions that we would want in the context of a hearing on that bill.
No, Alex, I agree with you. What you just said is different than not referring to the bill at all. What you just said is referring to the spirit and the concept of the bill and basically amending it. And that is right in the middle of what they typically allow people who testify to do. You know, are you for the bill? Are you for it with amendments? You know, et cetera. But they do try to get a sense as to where people are coming down. And I think what the board is saying is that you don't want to be tied to every word of the bill, which I definitely understand. I don't want to be tied to every word either. But that essentially we're supporting it with amendments. And here is what we think the end result should do. To me, that would be supporting it with amendments. But I feel like we dilute our influence somewhat if we insist upon not mentioning the bill number. I mean, you know, you can't even sign up to give them either written or oral testimony without, you know, without a bill number.
Kevin, in your language, did you mean uploaded or released?
Oh.
Kevin pasted the language in the chat. Well, I thought the word that was being used earlier was released.
I want everybody to read what Kevin
said. Give me a second to read this.
Janet, what I meant uploaded, I meant uploaded to the state server. Am I not using the correct terminology?
Yes, that's the correct terminology.
Who is Marty Mangold?
I don't know. I see he's put a message.
So what I meant by uploaded is, my understanding is that when Janet's team finishes, those results, the tapes are printed out, but there's no upload to a server that would show anyone the results until 8 o'clock on election night or until the polls close due to extended voting hours, which is, again, not any different than we do with early voting, because the staff is there during on election day uploading those, the memory sticks. And then at 8:01, and I remember Marianne was adamant it'd be at 8:01. Those results were to be, they were going to be at the State Board of Elections. So people would have the results from early voting right away.
Diane, go ahead.
Thank you, Madam President. And again, Alan, did you have your hand up before mine?
Maybe this time.
No, yours was
okay.
Yours was
okay. Well, we go first then.
I guess I appreciate all the comments. I think, given the convoluted course that this conversation has taken, it further reinforces what I think would be a mistake and what I can't support. And that is, I feel we've rushed into this. We haven't seen the language, and I, practically speaking, don't see how we could send something in the context of the hearing of a specific bill that would be supporting it in concept, that is not interpreted as a two-armed support of SB 163. I don't see the need for having to weigh in this in this context. If we want to send some sort of a motion at some point that we can have well thought out, that's not in the context of a public hearing for this specific legislation, that would be another issue. I think everyone knows where I stand.
Alan.
On Friday, I sent the bill for us to look at over the weekend. I quoted from the bill. I just became aware of the bill myself last week. I've forgotten Thursday or Friday, one of those days. It was an emergency bill introduced by Senator Kagan. She dropped it probably in November, December for consideration early in the session. We can't help that, but it's there. As David said, when you want to sign up to give any testimony, you have three choices. It's all mechanical. It's all online. You have to click a box. Do you want to do it for? You click a certain bill. You click on SB 163. That's the bill that you want to testify about. You want to testify for it or against it or for it with amendments. And you can do that now. I think that Allison has a placemaker position for us there with amendments. And then in the verbal testimony on Wednesday afternoon, either Nahid or whoever is going to be talking for us will say, here's what we believe. And at that point, it could be fine-tuned. We could even figure out some way of writing it down there. But before this testimony. But the point is that we're confined to what we can do, but I really think we need to support the legislation. We are the biggest county. Absentee ballots affect us more than anybody else, and we don't want to be stuck with having to open up the absentee ballots and start the processing 2 days after the election. Thank you.
David.
I just, first of all, I want to thank Alan for being on top of this in a way that I think is helpful to the board. Mm-hmm. I want to reiterate some of what he said. He sent us an email on Friday afternoon. He attached the bill, its full text. He gave us a heads up. He said he wanted it added to the agenda. He made clear that he wanted to discuss it at today's meeting. He said that Kevin agreed with him. I'm not quite sure what more could have been done to inform board members about what was in this bill. It's a matter of public record. You can go to the website, you can read it, but it was literally delivered to your inbox. So I really think that I understand the desire not wanting to be tied to specific language, but I think it's pretty clear. We all know about the legislative process and we all know about how it works in Annapolis. If they're having a hearing on this bill on Wednesday, our chance to influence it is now. If we wait a month, it'll be too late. And so we are the biggest beneficiary of this bill. In fact, I would argue in a way that the Board of Elections is the biggest beneficiary, not just our voters, because this is going to make our job a lot easier without sacrificing anything in the way of security. It's going to make it more efficient for us to get this done. So I'm very comfortable with most of what Kevin has written. I prefer to just say until the close of the polls without specifying 8 o'clock or extended hours, because obviously the polls close whenever they close. I would probably change the word uploaded to published, because I think that will be more understandable to the average person who's not into the details of our process. I even don't have a problem with, you know, without specifying the bill number, although I think that anyone who testifies will have to sign up to testify on a bill. But I think it's an opportunity for us, something that the board has been in favor of for a long time. And I think, it would be a mistake for us to decide that we have to, for whatever reason, put it off.
Diane.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you, Mr. Name. And I want to say duly chastised. I want to thank Alan for getting the information to us and recognize I misspoke. And David, thank you. It doesn't change how I feel, but I do appreciate that you did a yeoman's work in getting us the information ahead of time. And that was my mistake to misrepresent that.
Okay, we already talked enough about this subject. So let's come up with the motion as you watch everybody's voting.
Madam President, I think I have a possible way forward here. I think Mr. Vincent's proposal works for me with one very minor change, which is I would take out the word tabulated, since I think that we've already established that it is not a precise term. And I would think that without the word tabulated, that it would very well summarize what I think I heard today. I think it does get across what the board has said, but others can speak for themselves.
I would accept that.
Mm-hmm. Madam President, yeah. Then I guess the best course would be with that change, so it would read as election results shall be published or released, so the word tabulated is taken out. I would amend Mrs. Hober's second amendment to provide for that text as the amendment to Mr. Banoff's motion.
Why don't we withdraw all existing motions and substitute this as the motion?
Thank you.
With the correction just made by Alex.
Yes, thank you. That's exactly what I wanted to say.
We can do that by unanimous consent. So, we probably can.
Kevin, can you put the last things together?
Yes. And we can just, it's Alex, all previous motions are withdrawn. It's Alex's motion with the word tabulated removed. And
I second.
You go with Alex.
And appropriate commas adjusted as well. I don't think there'd be any commas. It would just say published or released with no commas.
Right.
Okay. So we are voting on Alex's motion, right? Right.
If it needs a second, perhaps we'll let Alan be the seconder since he proposed this in the
Alan
first place.
Alan already raised his hand. Alan, okay.
Ms. Cozume, okay. This is, yes, Lisa, ma'am. Marino. And for the records purposes, I just need to clarify, there was a lot of back and forth whether or not we're saying that the board supports a bill or the board supports Senate Bill 163.
Okay. Who's going to talk? Who's going to answer Lisa's?
Clarification
for the record.
Alex, go ahead.
I think that the text that I proposed with this change about deleting the word tabulated, I think that clearly does support SB 163, but with this conditions, you know, as we've said.
Okay.
Is that good, Lisa?
Yes.
Okay. So Alex's motion, second by Alan. Any discussion? No more discussion. Let's vote. Thank you. Those in favor of Alex with the correction, say yes. Aye.
Aye.
Alan? Or Alana?
Elise votes. I can't vote.
Aye.
Yeah. Elise, aye. Diane?
Abstain.
Ami?
You're on mute, Ami.
Yeah, at least
I'm sorry.
So I was looking at the faces. I didn't see your face. Go ahead, Alice.
Aye.
Are you going to vote?
Aye.
Right. Ami?
Aye.
I give my vote to Alex. Alex, you can vote.
Nahid has stepped out of the room.
I don't think that's possible. I appreciate it.
The lighting in the room is too bright. I can take a nap. Okay.
Madam President.
Nahid, I think you do need to vote. You're here.
Oh.
Can I go? if I leave the room.
She can leave, okay? Right?
Kevin,
you should Madam President, you should vote. I have no, if there was a regular member missing, I would be happy to vote in support of my own amendment or my own motion, but you should vote. So.
Okay, I say aye.
Madam President, I've been reminded that there are some people who are on by phone and cannot read the chat. So perhaps someone can, I can do it if you'd like, but perhaps someone can read the motion that we just passed for those who are on by phone.
Since Alan brought it up, let Alan read the motion.
No, Lisa, this is between better than me.
Alan or Alex, either one of you. Alex.
Or Alex, feel free.
Sure. So the text would be resolved that the Montgomery County Board of Elections supports SB 163 only on the condition that it be amended such that : A, absentee ballots may be opened, processed, duplicated, and scanned beginning 20 days before election day, : and B, no election results shall be published or released prior to the close of the polls.
Thank you. Thank you, Alex.
You got it.
So we got it. So it's passed. Right?
Thank you all.
Okay. Allison, do you have anything else to add? I hope not.
I defer to you, and I don't know if Kevin is our timekeeper. I know you have several other items on your agenda. I would be remiss, I think, if I did not mention Senate Bill 158, which is a legislative initiative of the Maryland Association of Counties. The county, Montgomery County, is supporting this bill. It is the bill to specify the terms for the 50-50 ratio of cost split for to specify that when the State Board of Elections mandates an expenditure on the local boards, that that would be a 50% reimbursement by the county. But that when the state does not mandate an expenditure and the county opts into it, then it would be 100%. Now, there's some language in that bill that Mayo is staying out of that bill because it also gets into other kinds of limitations on contracts in terms of the responsibilities of the state administrator and the state board. And I need you all to be aware of that as well. But I need you to know about that bill. I do not know whether you want to take a position on it or on the bill to prohibit basically fake ballot drop boxes that you spoke about earlier in the meeting. Those are the only other items I have.
David, but short talk.
Short talk. I think we should support legislation for the 50-50 split. I have some concerns with how the bill is written because it seems to emphasize the fact that the locals are required to pay the 50% without saying that the state is required to pay the other 50%. So I would phrase it differently. But I think that if we are of the opinion that I think we are, that we want to get some more legal backup for the 50-50 split, I think we should support it. I think we also should support making it illegal to have for people to have their own drop boxes that aren't ours. If they're within our jurisdiction, I thought the legislation said it pretty well. I can share screen if people are interested in that. I would think that these are pretty straightforward, and I definitely understand the desire not to spend a lot of time on it and also not to spend a lot of time wordsmithing.
Alan.
I have a motion for the board to support the amendments to election law. Two-110 to provide that there will be a split of 50-50 between the state and counties on equipment which is ordered by the state.
Just for clarification, is Mr. Banoff's amendment propose support that the board support only that aspect of SB 158 and not the other?
Yes. I'm just trying to, tease out that one part that we should all support. I agree. We should not involve the contract part beyond our needs, but we do need to codify 50-50.
David, your hand is up. You forgot to, or you want to start talk?
No, I will lower my hand.
Okay, lower your hand. So what is the motion for Lisa's knowledge? Yes, Diane.
Quick question. Allison, you mentioned that Mayo doesn't support other parts of the bill.
Mayo's taking no position on the bill.
Okay.
There are portions of the bill that relate to the state board, and that are not directly related to us, and I think that may be part of the motivation of why they are not taking a position. She didn't say that they were opposed to it, they're just staying out of it.
Are these issues that, so if it's the state,
It's requirements for if the state administrator has a contract renewal, change order, it requires those things to go before the state board. I think that's the primary question.
Did someone second Alan's motion?
Who second Alan's motion?
Seconded.
Well, actually, I think Mr. Banoff should read his motion for clarification. Once it's read, then it will be before the board and ready to be seconded.
Oh, I thought he did, but go ahead, Alan.
Okay, I'll try again. Motion that the county board support the provisions in Senate Bill 158 to amend the election law section 2-110 to provide that there will be a 50-50 split between the counties and states on state ordered equipment.
Okay.
Isn't that more narrow than what the bill says about the 50-50 split? Is it only about equipment?
Well, I was short term. It's goods and services. It's goods and services.
Well, then let's not limit ourselves to goods.
Goods and services.
So it's state mandated goods and services, right?
Yes.
Okay.
What I have is motion that the county board support the provisions in Senate Bill 158 to amend the election law section 2-110 to provide that there will be a 50-50 split between the counties and state on state mandated goods and services. Is that correct?
Okay, that's the motion. Yeah. Who seconded?
I did.
Elise seconded. Okay. Diane, yes.
Is it helpful to add, and we are silent on other portions of the bill?
I don't think we need to say that.
I think we are silent on other portions of the bill because I think the motion said that it was only talking about that portion.
Okay, good. Thanks.
Okay, Kevin, where are you?
I'm here.
Is that good enough?
Yes, it's been a motion and a second. And this is, you know, as the board knows, this has been an ongoing debate because the state has declined to pay for certain things.
Yeah. Those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. It's passed. Thank you. Any other new business before we go to old business?
Is the board interested in supporting the legislation on the fake drop boxes? I mean, to me, that would be something that we might all support, that the only, that basically others, if you want, I can find you the legislation itself. It's very short. But basically, the requirement is, and maybe you guys don't, maybe want to stick with the idea of doing things by concept. But the concept is that it is not legal for essentially any entity other than, you know, the State Board of Elections or us to collect ballots in drop boxes in Montgomery County.
Is it a criminal statute? The bill would propose a criminal penalty?
Well, hang on a second and let me pull it up.
Yes, felony.
Yes, it is.
A felony. A fine up to $10,000 or imprisonment for not more than 3 years or both. Mm-hmm.
And what? How do they phrase it? As a drop box that is procured by the State Board of Elections, or
let me pull it up.
Yeah, I'm gonna find it.
I mean, that's probably what it is. You probably don't need to. But.
Well, how about let me share my screen, and then I'll also read it out loud if I can figure out how to share my screen correctly. Oh,
they won't let you do it.
The host has disabled participant screen sharing. Okay, I guess I'm not going to share my screen.
But here's what I'm going to do.
I just
put it into the chat box.
Here we go.
Yeah, the numbers there are the line numbers. So you can just ignore where it says 11, 12, 13.
Okay, so for people that are on the phone, the language is an individual, an organization, an association, a political party, or 11
Any other person.
Any other person may not collect absentee ballots during an election in a container that is not a ballot drop box that is officially designated by the state board or a local board, but is labeled, marked, or otherwise designated to appear to be an official or unofficial ballot drop box.
And then it goes on to say, any person who violates this section 9312 of this subtitle is guilty of a felony and is subject to a fine of not more than $10,000 or imprisonment for not more than 3 years or both.
Okay, that's good. That's good enough. So,
I would move that we support this bill.
Yeah. Second, who's going to second it?
I'll second.
Elise seconded. A discussion? Those in favor say aye.
I have a quick question.
Yes.
So I apologize, gang, but does anywhere in that, does it define what a ballot drop box is? I know it says not officially designated by, but
I believe that the law defines it in this part of this law that is not being changed.
Okay.
But hang on, let me see if I have to pull it up.
Yes. Well, you went through the process last month of designating the
Well, not only that, yeah. In 1101, there is a definition of ballot drop box. Would you like me to read it? But obviously.
I mean, is it long?
I just put in the chat box.
Here it is: secure, durable, weatherproof container. Okay, thank you.
Yes. So. Those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, passed. Thank you. Any other new business? Yes, some new business.
I think Elise had committees as new business.
But before you get to committees, just one thing I'd like to say, which is that I was planning to testify virtually on the legislation at these the three pieces of legislation that we've taken a position on. In order to sign up, I had to sign up before 3 o'clock. So I signed up as an individual. My plan would be to use my time to support and explain what the board just did, and not to depart at all from what the board just did.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
I also signed up to support two bills. Senate Bill 163 on the opening of ballots early, and then supporting the 50-50 split in Senate Bill 158.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
Yeah, for Alan. So Alan, Mr. Bannon, would with those comments be in the mold of what Mr. Naiman said his would be and not stray outside of what the board has agreed to today? Or do you plan a full-throated support?
Well, I submitted a written testimony on the very same lines as we supported here today. Different language, but the same meaning. I can send it all to you. For the Senate Bill 158, I just signed up for oral testimony, and I can just simply say I agree with David.
Well, we don't know which one of us signed up first, so it may be that I'm going to say I agree with Alan.
Yeah.
We'll give you that latitude.
Yeah, we appreciate that. I would say that, you know, if I'm asked my personal opinion on something, as you know, it's hard to resist, but it would certainly be labeled as such. But my thought is that it'll be much more powerful for all of us to talk about what we all agree to. And I appreciate the fact that the board took the time to figure out what we all agree to and came to, you know, largely a consensus. So that's why that would be the focus of what I would say.
Okay. And then keep in mind that support for 153 was 163, I'm sorry, was not unanimous.
I've lost track as to which bill was which.
That was the first one, early opening.
Right. I would not use the word unanimous for
okay.
sure.
Okay. Thanks.
Diane, I did hear your views expressed today.
Thank you.
And previously.
Ad nauseum. I apologize to everyone.
I didn't
okay.
say that.
Thank you. Any other new business, or we can go to old business, talk about
committees.
Yes, the committees.
Elise, go ahead.
Yes, just through Allison's report, I noticed that there were the topics that were the subject of committee work, at least in the past. And so I'm assuming that they will continue to be part of the committee work going forward. Having worked with Jackie Phillips on the outreach committee, I know that we have new members. So I'm wondering who my committee member would be on the outreach committee. And I always hate to assume. So I just wanted to make sure that the members of the budget and legislative committees had not changed or had they. I just wanted to make sure that I was not making any assumptions.
No, nothing's been changed except the outreach. I'm going to do it with you.
Oh, okay.
The rest of them are the same. Okay.
All right. So the budget committee is you and Alan?
No, you and me, only two. Oh, the budget, me and Alan. Yes.
Yes. And the legislative committee is Alan and Diane. Is that correct? Okay.
So Madam President, you're serving on two committees?
Yes. But they want me to be there because I know a little bit about budget, since we don't have a budget person.
So understood. I was just referring to the outreach that you are taking over on outreach as well. I guess Mr. Vincent had his fill of outreach when he and I were on outreach together. But
you want to do outreach?
But I don't know whether Ms. Hobart has given it a chance to serve.
You're welcome. Whoever wanted, you can have it. I mean, I'm not asking for more work. you can have it. They just ask me to be there, the people, the staff, because the budget, I know a little bit more about budget. So since they don't have a budget person, we can help them. So whatever.
Naheed, you know more about most of our subjects, having been on the board for as long as you have. So,
A century.
A century, not quite. Not quite, but okay.
Well,
whatever.
Madam President, I did serve on the outreach committee with Mr. Naiman when I was in my first term on the board. I'd be pleased to do so again, but I'm not, necessarily lobbying for it. But if I know the president, the chains of office often weigh heavily upon thee. So if I can lighten your load, then I'd be pleased to do that.
So you want to be in the outreach committee, Alex?
Sure.
Yes?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
Give away with words, Alex.
Not to mention that I'm sure working with Elise will be a happier experience than working
okay,
with
me. Okay, then you solve it among yourself. I don't care now.
It's and legislation? Am I still on legislation?
Yes, legislation. Who's going to talk about it? Who's in there? Diane, and you, Alan?
Yep.
Diane?
Yep.
Okay, who's going to talk?
That's all.
5 second talk. Go ahead.
Oh.
No, but are we appointed to the legislation committee?
Yes, we are.
If you want to.
Okay. End of discussion.
If Army wants, Army can have it. Army, do you want to have any committee?
What are the options?
A lot of work. No, the option is whatever.
Yeah, we'll talk about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, solve it among yourself, Diane, and tell me next
board. No, I know. I said I'm happy to be on legislation.
Yeah, you were this last time. Okay. Well, when second. So any old business? Action item?
Madam President, do we have to approve the minutes, I believe?
No, we're going to do it. That's next.
Oh, that's next. Okay.
Yeah. After approve, after item, action items. Any action items? No?
The only action items that I have from the meeting are that we will proceed to line up committee meetings for each of the committees. I will, I got a message earlier that I believe you have all now been invited to the meeting with the county executive on the budget, and I will follow up and either affirm that we will be discussing both the supplemental and the FY23 budget in that same meeting, or follow up on expectations for when we'll be when the board will have an opportunity to be directly involved in a future meeting on the supplemental. And I will also, Janet and I will work to pull together some more user-friendly information for our website on the status of redistricting. We will also follow up with you on the information that we have on, we'll provide you the information that we have on the current status of redistricting and the precincts that are in yes. in the districts.
Yes, please, yes.
And we have board members testifying this afternoon. I have signed, not this afternoon. We have board members testifying on Wednesday. I have signed up to testify for information only and will defer to the board members and to the Maryland Association of Election Officials unless there are any direct questions for me.
All right. Thank you so very much. Now, yes, now approval of the minute, November 15, 2021.
Madam President?
Yes, ma'am.
Madam President, I would make a motion that we, that the board approve the minutes of the November 15th, 2021 meeting as edited by Mr. Banoff and I believe Mr. Naiman with two additional changes. On page three, I think the intent was to refer to the Kennedy Shriver, not Kennedy Shrive Aquatic Center. That's in the third paragraph from the bottom.
Yes,
my mistake, thank you.
And then after where it, two lines down from that where it says 2020 cost, I would ask that we put in the word unit cost. It's probably obvious because I can't believe that all 56 drop boxes will only cost $1,500, yes. But it's probably worth making that clear. So thank with you, those two additions, that would be the substance of my motion, Madam President.
I second the motion. Second.
Discussion. Those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Thank you. It has passed December 2nd, 2021. That was a special.
I move we accept those minutes.
Second.
That's it. Did Alan have comments on those as well?
Yeah, I did.
Are those incorporated in your motion, Diane?
Yes, I assume that was the set that Madam President had referred to.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, any discussion? No, those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Nothing. Our next meeting is on February 28th, 2022.
Madam President, we have our second executive session at 5:30. Yes. So if we could try and make this first executive session about 15 minutes, we have other people from the county that I they were supposed to be on at 4:30. I pushed it back to 5:30.
Okay, but we have another session, so we can go to that session. So I mean, executive things, we can get out of the public meeting and go to
I need all of the board members just to stay on. Don't do anything, okay? I'll move you to the new room.
Okay,
before
you do that, go ahead, Alan, but I want to say something too.
I just want to say, Allison had a very thorough first report. I want to thank you, and thank you for being very clear and thorough. A very good maiden voyage.
Thank you.
I want to second what Alan said about Alison's report, but my reason for raising my hand is because I want to thank Lisa for having gotten us the minutes at a very early stage this time, which allowed for plenty of time for review. So thank you, Lisa, for doing that for us.
And so I'm Janet.
Madam President?
Yes.
Thank you so much. I just want to confirm we just need to adjourn, a motion for adjournment before we actually get moved to the other meeting.
I need a motion for adjournment.
So move.
Second?
Second.
And a second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No. All right, then we go to join that is at room one. All right. Thank you so much. See you a little bit
later. I just need you all to join the room.
Yes, thank you.